say, and I believe that I am what my Bible says that I am. Now, if my Bible says it, I have a right to say it. My Bible says that I'm more than a conqueror. My Bible says I'm an heir of God. Join ears with Jesus. That makes me want to shout. There we go. My mind's alert. My heart is open. And we're going to.
Well, I've been a soldier in God's mighty army since many long years ago. I've been scarred, wounded in battle, Lord, many times I've been wrong, Lord. But by the signs of the time, I realize there's only one more mile to go. Is that the lights of heaven up above? I feel like running. Good to have Paul Rigdon here today.
Amen.
Him and David and Jason are going to have some special music for us. So we're going to sing a couple and get out of the way for them. But James, you got a song for us this morning?
Gee. Well, there's still a lot of mine. I'm going to let you in. There's still a lot of mine. I'm going to let it shine. I'm gonna let it shine, let it shine, let it shine, let it shine. Well, now everywhere I go, I'm gonna let it shine. Everywhere I go, I'm gonna let it shine. Everywhere.
Simple course that is true. Yes. Is that right?
Yes.
Tell you what, let's get Jordan up here to sing one more Shining Your Light song there one time. Y'all make welcome Jordan. Just grab that red microphone right there, Jordan.
To brave the dark and let my little light shine. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine, gonna let it shine.
Thanks, Jordan. Now, Jason, don't you do a Henson song? Like one of my favorite songs you do? Isn't that a Kenny Henson song?
Which one?
That one, If I Could Still Go Free?
Let me find it. I Had Mercy Walked In picked out.
You have what?
But I can do that.
Mercy Walked In, that's him too, isn't it?
I'm not really sure. That's Gordon Moat.
Huh?
That's Gordon Moat.
Oh, okay. Do him a Henson song, man. That's
all right, let's do
song.
Still Go Free. Kissy.
Reach down his head. not fit to keep. But a man on that cross, he put me in his will and said that I could still go free. A man on the cross, he put me in his will and said that I could still
Now, if you have a prayer request, this is your time. Oh, we're going to do it different. Let's rewind that. We walk, we walk.
I want everyone just to stand. We're going to do it just a little different today. Part of the reason why we're doing it different, we got a number of people here that they felt they wanted to come, but they're not feeling 100%. And Steve Terry is going to come by and hug and kiss him, aren't I? Right? But now when God heals him, then it's okay. So we're going to change it up just a little bit. If you have a need today, Matt had to leave. Matt's not feeling good. If you have a need today, whether it's physical, spiritual, emotional, would you step out to an aisleway just today, and then we'll go back to normal probably next week. It's a faith thing, folks. If you're looking at me, wrong guy. Wrong guy. You're looking at Barry. Barry tell you, wrong guy. You better look to Jesus, because he's the author and finisher of our faith. Author and finisher. Now, I need, Ross can't be all by himself. I'm here by myself. I need somebody to be with somebody. Do not let anybody be by themselves. Do not let anybody be by themselves. Nobody. We got some in the back. Ross, get around and look and see who you need to be with. If you're by yourself still, nobody's there to pray for you, let us know so we can have somebody with you. Do not be by yourself. Okay? Do not be by yourself. Okay? I know that I got one couple back here by themselves in the very back row. Somebody move. There you go. Raymond and Betty. Okay, there you go. There you go. If you're a visitor, we believe in ministry. This part, as long as I'm a pastor, will be here. We're going to pray for people. Okay? Who's that for? Cancer. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Father, we thank you that we can come to a living God. It is said in the word that you know what we need before we even ask it, however we're to ask. Some, Lord, are coming because of illnesses. Some, God, are coming because they have to go to their heavenly Father. That's it. They don't know what else to do. In the name of Jesus, you see their hearts, you see their minds, you see their condition. Some, God, don't even know what they're going to do about food next week. In the name of Jesus, a miracle, so that they can testify what their Father did, not what the church did, not what their Father did. We bring it to your attention. Speak healing to the minds, the souls. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. At this time, we generally hug necks and everything. We're going to give our guest speaker a little bit more time, so you may be seated. I need my usherettes to come. We're going to take up God's tithe and your offering, so the usherettes will come. You may be seated. This is totally, I know a lot of you, if you're visitors, you're saying, what's going on? Nobody knows what's going on. This is all brand new. The kids are going to go back. Wasn't that a great testimony about what Kyler said? I should have had an amen on that one. Great testimony. Great testimony. We had another one just tell us a while ago that we've been praying for her mother, and she just told us a while ago that it looks like God's answered that prayer. Love it. I love it. Hey, when God gets the credit, man's out of it. All right, hop along. Would y'all make welcome Sister Mickey Edwards today? She's been a little sick.
Love you, Mickey.
Love you, Mickey. Brother Denny Crow is back with us today.
Yeah.
It's good to see you, Denny. Love you, buddy. Those of you that I've had a dozen people say, "Oh, I love your tie." That's compliments of Brother Denny. So he did a good job. Yeah. April's tired of dressing me, so Denny's kind of picked up to. Now he's not dressing me; he's just helped selecting my clothes. Let me make sure that's right. Okay. Okay. Shall we pray? Father, for this day, we are grateful. We have so much to be grateful for, Father. We live in a country that currently we can still worship you and call you by name. We can still call upon you to hear and answer our prayers. They haven't taken that away from us. We thank you, Lord. We ask you to bless this offering. Bless those that have the ability to give. And then those that don't, so that they can. Prosper us as long as we reach out to you with more souls. In Jesus' name we pray. And everybody said,
amen.
Amen. Jordan.
The shadows, bound for the gallows, a dead man walking, to love came calling, rise up,
rise up,
rise up,
rise up.
6 feet under, I thought it was over, an answer to prayer, the voice of a Savior, rise up,
rise up,
rise up. These are
say praise the Lord. If you don't understand what that was, it said that in the Bible that Jesus was talking to the disciples and they had called to let him know that Lazarus, his dear friend was sick. Would you come and pray for him and he'd be healed? My God.
Hey.
And he abode 4 more days. And finally he says, well, we better go see Lazarus. Said he's sleeping. And the disciples said, well, if he's sleeping, isn't that good? He said, no, you don't understand, you bunch of dummies, he's dead. And when he got there, can you visualize that? Close your eyes and visualize it. Mary and Martha come a running. If you'd have been here, Martha sings that song 4 days. If you'd have been here, he said, I am the resurrection alive. Amen. And they said that Lazarus was down in the grave, and he's talking to Peter, James, and John. No, he's talking to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And as he was talking to them, they said, we know about him. And they said that Lazarus says, yeah, but I know him personally. I think Carmen had that. He said, I know him personally. He calls me by name. In fact, oh my gracious, he's calling me now. And when Jesus called him, Lazarus, come forth. He came. Why did he say Lazarus? Why didn't he just say come forth? Because everybody in the grave would have come forth if it wasn't Lazarus. My Lord, get a hold of that. And he's calling your name today, too. He's calling your name. He's calling. Would you grab a hold of that? And when she gets to that part, I thought I was too far gone. Currently, that is my favorite song.
Yeah.
Come on up here, Paul. That's my favorite song. Come on, Paul. Those visitors, thank you. I'm fixing to turn the thing from heat to cool. That's hot. Maybe because we're just feeling it. This man is a, thank you, Benton. He takes care of me. Y'all take care of me. This man is a magnificent man. If you're around him for just a little bit, you're going to love his spirit. He's not brash like David or myself. David and I have developed a wonderful friendship, I guess, the last 5 or 6 months, only to find out. We went and picked up that piano, David and I, and I quoted something from Ray Stevens, whom I love. Those of you who don't know anything about Ray Stevens. And I said, you know, I just come down from Coonsbury, Oregon, at top of trees. And David said, and he might be a logger. You have to look that up. And David introduced me to this magnificent man. And would you make welcome a friend to our church, Brother Paul Rigdon, please.
Praise the Lord. What a wonderful morning to be in God's house. Amen. You know, I was kind of raised in church. I wasn't born there, but I was born again there. Amen. How about you?
There you go.
Glory to God for his salvation, for his saving grace. But I was blessed. When I was born to parents that believed in God, believed in taking their family to church. There was 9 of us. I was number 8 of 9. And I thank God that there's enough food to go around most times. I thank you because my house was full of music, scripture, love, and these wonderful gifts were part of my heritage. And I wrote this song about my mom and dad. Dad was a country preacher. Y'all probably heard me say this before. Mom was the janitor and the Sunday school teacher and the song leader and all that stuff. But mainly, she was a prayer warrior.
Yes, she was.
And she could reach up and rattle the gates of heaven on behalf of those of us who didn't have sense enough most of the time to pray for ourselves. And I'm so glad that I had that.
Amen.
And I wrote this song in their honor. It's called Daddy Preached, Mama Prayed. Back in my days of childhood, memories I love most. Down at the country church house, led by the Holy Ghost, we would have a big revival. How the sinners would get saved when Daddy preached and Mama prayed. Oh, the singing, it was glorious. The enemy was
sisters and my brothers, just children at the time, would hear the call of Jesus, the altar they would find. No joy could ever be greater than the joy our hearts display when Daddy preached and Mama prayed. Now time keeps marching onward, and one day this life will end.
David's favorite song that we do. So he gave me this idea for this song. It goes kind of like this. You know, we're saved by grace. We're washed in his blood. We're filled with the Spirit. We're on our way to heaven. Our chains have been broken. But sometimes idiots like me will drag that stuff along behind us. But we all just leave it laying. This song says, there's no use in dragging those broken chains. Can you tap dance?
I was trying to think of something funny to do there, but I just couldn't come up with it.
That would be funny if you were to tap dance.
Yes. Yes.
I think. Well, our band is on strike.
Okay. All right. We'll do something different.
Okay.
Tune back up, brother.
Now I got tune back up. Thank you.
if the wind must keep blowing for me to trust in you, then Lord, I will hold on until you see me through. I may not know the purpose of this trial that I face, but don't let this storm I lived my life in bondage, suffered shame and grief. There was no such thing as freedom. It was too good to believe. When a gray-haired country preacher touched my heart one Sunday night, my blinded eyes began to see the light. Though I was delivered, a burden yet remained. Why do I keep dragging broken chains? Broken chains. Go and lay them down. There's no need to carry them around. Prison walls are falling by the power of Jesus' name.
Well, just let go and drop those
broken chains.
Broken
chains. Holding on to relics from the years I was enslaved. Like the useless broken shackles that fell off when I got saved. The Lord is calling now for me to leave all that behind. Don't go back to chains that used to bind. Cause on the cross he signed my pardon. His blood cleansed every stain. So why do I keep dragging broken chains?
Broken chains. Let go and lay them The scars will still remind me of the struggle and the sin. But I hear the Lord tell me I'm free again.
Broken chains
can't hold you anymore. Leave them on the floor and walk away. Prison walls have fallen by the power of Jesus' name.
Well, just let go and drop those broken chains.
Let go and lay them down. There's no need to carry them around.
Prison walls have fallen by the power of Jesus' name.
Well, just let go and drop those broken chains.
Let go, stop dragging broken chains.
Dragging those broken chains. Amen. Praise God. Well, happy Groundhog Day, everybody. February the 2nd. Not being a sports fan, I had forgotten all about it being Super Bowl Sunday. Not that I don't like sports, just that all the other kids were out playing football and stuff. I was slumped over my guitar and trying, trying to make up songs like Broken Chains. I'm so glad the Lord has brought us here on this Sunday morning. Appreciate you, Brother Steve, for inviting me to share what's on my heart. And how many of you heard me preach before? Three or four? Thank you all for coming. Anyway, I appreciate so much. Your vote of confidence means a lot to me. So it is Groundhog Day, February 2nd. How many of us celebrated this morning by eating some sausage for breakfast? Groundhog? Okay, being familiar with Brother David East, I figured y'all were, you know, used to bad puns, so I just wanted to check your tolerance for bad jokes. Now I know. Well, legend has it that the groundhog pokes his head out of his little burrow this morning and sees a shadow, then we're in for another 6 weeks of winter. Now, as David enlightened me that he didn't see a shadow this morning, and, you know, that's okay, but according to my calendar, your calendar probably reads just like my calendar, from February 2nd to March the 22nd, first day of spring, is 7 weeks. So, you know, we're ahead of the game anyway. And it doesn't matter if the overgrown rodent sticks his head out and sees a shadow or if he sees little green men from Mars dancing around out there. The calendar rules. Well, back in the early days of my attempts at ministering the word, I was given the opportunity to preach on Groundhog Day. And that came to mind whenever Pastor Steve first gave me this invitation. See, back in the old Christ Corner Church, there were several preachers, a bunch of preachers. I mean, we had a plethora, a veritable cornucopia, as Brother David might say. Lots of preachers. Pastor would give us all a chance from time to time, maybe once a month or something, he'd let one of us preach on a midweek service. 6 or 8 weeks, maybe a Sunday service. And every once in a while, it would even fall on a holiday or a special occasion. Like, of course, you'd expect the pastor to preach on Christmas and Easter Sunday and all that. He might give one of the elder deacons the chance on Memorial Day, or maybe the youth pastor get to preach for 4th of July. And, you know, he's a firecracker anyway. And or even Thanksgiving week, you know. And what awesome material for a passionate message those occasions would give. But I was about fourth string at best, so I got Groundhog Day. Whether or not that was, you know, intended as a sermon material, I don't know, but it came to be as soon as the invitation was given that if the old groundhog would just turn toward the light, then he wouldn't see his shadow. Amen? Okay, it's physics. Y'all get that, don't you? So this morning, I want to admonish us all to turn toward the light. About that. I'm going to read from Genesis chapter 1 and the first three verses. Y'all could probably quote them along with me. But these words are written there. In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. And the earth was without form and void. And darkness was upon the face of the deep. And the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the waters. And God said, let there be light. And there was light. Amen to God's word. Lord, thank you for the privilege to stand behind the sacred desk among your people and expound the word as you've helped me to be inspired with it this morning. And I just ask that you would cause it to sink into our hearts and cause us to turn toward the light this morning. Let your words be my words. Let your will be my will. We ask it in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. All right. Now, darkness, technically speaking, is just the absence or the deficiency of light. Amen. Darkness is measured or defined only by the amount or the presence or the lack of the presence of light. Darkness actually came before light by only one verse. Verse 1, God created. Verse 2, the earth was out without form and void. There was a void, an emptiness. There was a profound darkness that covered the entire creation. You know, it seems like dark is the default position, if you will. When I start my computer up, there are several particular programs that run. There's a picture of a guitar, of course, that comes up on my screen and that I've chosen in advance. There's icons lined up that represent various functions at various times that I use. And, the computer knows which music recording program I like, which photo editing software and video player, what keystrokes and mouse clicks and shortcuts. It knows what printer I like to use. These are the default settings. So it would appear that when you speak a planet into existence, then the default position for the electromagnetic radiation in the portion of the spectrum that includes the wavelengths which illuminate objects or stimulate the eye to send impulses to the brain to be interpreted as images. The default position for the cosmic light switch is off. There was a void in this newly created universe, an emptiness, an absence of light. Well, you know that in all of eternity past, they didn't have any use for light. They didn't have any need for light. Because 1 John 1:5 says that God is light. And in him is no darkness at all. Amen? And as God was then, God is now. And as God is now, God always will be. He changes not. Amen? In eternity future, again, we'll have no need for light. Because I read the back of the book. And Revelation 22:5 says there'll be no night there. They shall need no candle, neither the light of the sun, for the Lord God giveth them light. Praise God, the Lamb is the light. But God decided, as he laid out his plans, and he designed space and time and matter and energy, before he even created the earth, he decided he'd give a special significance to light. You and I and all of our life on earth would be dependent on the existence of light. So God Almighty, in a special act of creation, said, let there be light. Now, maybe a more precise translation from Hebrew would have the Creator saying, light be. He commanded light to appear out of utter darkness, and there was light. God, by the power of his will and his word, produced light. There's no gadget or mechanism in existence to produce darkness. Let me say that again. There's no gadget or mechanism in existence to produce darkness. Darkness is just the absence of light. It's like a placeholder just waiting for the light to come. Darkness is what remains after switching off or blocking out the light. If there was a gadget or a mechanism, what would you call it? A flash dark?
Let there be dark.
you turn the batteries around backwards in your flashlight, and it's a flash dark, I guess. I worked a rotating shift many years ago, and when I was on midnight shift, a 19-year-old getting off from work at 8 a.m. on a sunny day, I tell you, it was hard to convince me that it was bedtime. Y'all may know what I'm talking about. I had to put black plastic, thick sheets of plastic over my bedroom windows so I could get some sleep to block out the light. I couldn't simply flip a switch and turn on the dark. You don't tell your kids, turn on the dark and go to sleep, y'all. I don't know if they'd get it or not, but God didn't use his infinitely creative power to say, let there be dark. But he said, let there be light. And immediately there was light in a flash, if you will. David got that pun. He's the pun meister. One of the fundamental constants of nature is the speed of light. At 186,282 miles per second, it takes light about 8.3 minutes to reach the Earth from the surface of the sun. The speed of light is so constant and so precise that other things are measured by it. You've heard about light years as a measure of distance through outer space. For instance, the next galaxy from ours is something like 25,000 light years. It's closer than Andromeda. They've discovered another one that's closer. Yeah, it's a small, but it counts, I guess. If Pluto can be a planet, then Canis Major can be a galaxy. But 25,000 years traveling at the speed of light, that's fast. That's a long way. It's a measure of distance. Did you know that the metric system that we use, or well, most countries use, we're a little behind on that. But the length of a meter is based on the speed of light in a vacuum. But you never hear of anything traveling at the speed of dark, because dark's not going anywhere. Amen? But, well, the possible exception of Muhammad Ali, he said, I'm so fast, I can turn off the light switch and I can be in bed before it gets dark in there. That's right. That's floating, not quite like a butterfly, but this darkness is not going anywhere. It just sits there waiting to be touched by the light. Now, once the darkness is pierced by the light, it's no longer completely dark. Amen? But darkness has no similar power over light. Objects may cast shadows, but that's only in relation to how much light there is around. But if you add more light, if you add light from every direction, the darkness is driven away completely. Darkness has no power over light, but light has a power of its own, because it was spoken into existence on day one of the universe by the voice of the Almighty God. Light provides a fuel for every living thing on earth. Y'all know about photosynthesis, how that the plants take carbon dioxide and water, and by the power of the sunlight, they produce simple sugars that feed the plant and feeds all the animals that eat the plant. Y'all may not have a taste for grass, but my God invented a process to turn grass into ribeye steaks. Bless his name. Yeah, that deserves an amen right there. I'm glad he chose to do that. So according to God's plan, with light comes life. The two are inseparable. Every day of creation, at the end of the day, God's own words were, and it was good. Genesis 1 and 4, God saw the light and he said, he saw that it was good. God is good. God's plan for mankind is good. Light is good and life is good. But at times, it seems that our perception is off. John 3:19 says that men love darkness rather than light because their deeds were evil. And the 20th verse goes on to say, he that doeth evil hateth the light because he won't come to the light because it'll manifest his deeds. It'll show his evil deeds. In today's culture, death is glorified and darkness is magnified, and the perceived absence of light is almost overwhelming sometimes. But notice again, Genesis 1, 2, before light was ever created, darkness was on the face of the deep. But you think that was a problem for God, the creator? Very next sentence says, And the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the waters, the face of the deep. Moved upon the face of the waters. And that gives me confidence and consolation this morning to realize that my God can move even in the darkest situation. He's more than able to move and operate when the world is covered in darkness, when it's defined by darkness. And he's more than able to speak into your dark situation and cause his light to come pouring in. Another time God proved his ability to move upon the face of the water, the gospel account of the disciples caught out in the middle of the stormy sea. Their tiny ship was tossed. If not for the courage of, no. Of the water walking lifeguard. Amen. They were all afraid there were going to be fish food in just about another minute. And all of a sudden, here walking on the sea comes Jesus Christ. You think they looked up and said, here comes Jesus. Everything's going to be all right now. No. Matthew, I believe it was 16 and 26, said that they thought it was a ghost. They cried out for fear. How sad, how similar to today's culture, that they'd rather believe in ghosts than believe in the power of God to save and to rescue them out of their situation. Ascribe to the Lord greatness and glory. Don't give his glory to anybody else, anything else, especially to darkness that has no power of its own. It's just a placeholder waiting for the light. Ascribe unto the Lord greatness that is due his name. Dark times, dark circumstances cannot prevent his spirit from moving in our world and in our lives. There's no darkness so dark that it can overcome his light. Amen? And when we're surrounded by darkness, first thing he wants to do is to give us light. And with light comes life. Amen. But in this nihilistic culture that celebrates darkness and death, it offers only hopelessness. But we, the Bible says, 1 Peter 1:9, we are a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a peculiar people, that we should show forth the praises of him who has called us out of the darkness into his marvelous light. Amen. He's called us out of the darkness into his marvelous light. Isaiah the prophet said, Isaiah 9:2, the people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. They that dwell in the land of the shadow of death, upon them the light hath shined. How many know that's us? Death from the very fall of man. Death has cast a long and a dark shadow. You and I were born under its curse. But as dark and hopeless as the shadow of death may seem, we were offered hope one morning when the grave turned up empty. Praise God, and death woke up dead on that Sunday morning, that resurrection morning. 2 Corinthians 4:6 is, for God, who commanded the light to shine out of darkness, has shined in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. Jesus came to this dark, dying world. He said, John 8:12, I'm the light of the world. He that followeth me shall not walk in darkness, but shall have the light of life. And I love that phrase, the light of life. You know why? Because it's the exact opposite of the shadow of death. The light of life. Praise God. We have that in Jesus Christ. And it's a choice. It's our choice. Choose darkness. Choose light over darkness. Choose life over death. Turn toward the light, would you? Many have chosen to block out the light. Like, I was trying to sleep. I had to do something, and that was the last resort. Just ain't natural to sleep in the daytime. But people block out the light. The spiritual light. But the light's been revealed to us in the face of Jesus Christ. As though they take their candle and hide it under a bushel rather than putting it on a candlestick. Jesus was talking about as part of the Sermon on the Mount, Matthew 5. But If you put that on a candlestick, it gives light to all that are in the house. It blessed my heart when Brother Al started singing that this little light of mine, this sister sang that great song about this light. It just gave me confirmation that somebody need to hear about the light and how it has power over darkness this morning. And if I just want you to get this through your soul. If you're tired of walking in darkness, Jesus is calling you out of the darkness and into his marvelous light. If you've had enough of hopelessness and depression and fear of darkness, darkness is just a placeholder waiting to be touched by the light. Turn toward the light. Turn toward the light of life, Jesus Christ. Would you stand with me this morning? Thank you for your attention. Just a few more comments. And then Brother David is going to take us all out to lunch, is what I heard. Bless his heart.
He didn't feel Jesus in that one.
He did. You didn't get a witness there. I'm so thankful that we've been called out of the darkness and into his marvelous light. So you don't have to be afraid of your own shadow and look for a hole to crawl into like the old groundhog. As surely as God said, light be, the darkness was immediately replaced with light, because God is light. He wants to speak into your darkness. He wants to speak into your chaos and distress and say, peace be still, because he is our peace. Amen. He can speak to your disease and say, be in perfect health, because he's our healer. He can speak into a heart that is utterly broken and say, be made whole, because God is love. If you're lost and don't know which way to turn, he'll lead you beside still waters, because he's the good shepherd. He'll make you able to lay down in green pastures. He'll restore your soul. If you have any need whatsoever, whatever you're lacking, he's able to say there's plenty, because he is our provider. Amen. This is a wonderful God I serve. And I invite you this morning, if you don't know him, that you would come to know Jesus this morning. If we could bow our heads and close our eyes and just imagine the Creator speaking into utter darkness, utter hopelessness, utter chaos, and saying, let there be light. And suddenly everything changed. The world that was just created, I don't know if it was literal days or if it was some time period that the Bible says in 6 days he created all this. Scientists want to construe that as some longer era of time. Whatever time it was, the world that he created was in darkness and chaos, it was void. And the split second that God said, let there be light, praise God, immediately, in a flash, there was light. Life-giving light. And this morning, if you feel like you're in chaos, if you feel like you're in darkness and hopelessness, whatever the case may be, Jesus is the light of life. And I offer him to you this morning. With all of my heart, I implore you, come to know Jesus. If there's one that would come to pray for anything that I've mentioned, whether it's your situation, whether it's your broken heart, whether it's your need, your disease, your chaos, your darkness, depression, turn to the light this morning. If you feel to come and pray, I know there are people here who will pray with you. Maybe even that know your situation, or maybe no one here knows your situation, but Jesus knows. God knows. He feels your pain. He feels your despair, whatever it is. He knows your need. You simply turn to the light. You won't see those shadows. Glory to the name of the Lord Jesus. Praise God. Stepped out in faith, believing that you are our healer, that you are our provider, you are the source of our supply. Father, I ask that his faith be rewarded with healing. Lord, we know that you are able, you're uniquely able to heal that which you created, to make it every whit whole, as you did when you walked on the earth, and multitudes were healed of their infirmities. We're asking specifically, Lord, this morning, for Brother Al, that you touch his body. Father, that he be made every whit whole.
Yes.
Let the world know that it was because of you, because of the stripes that you took in our place, that Brother Al has healing this morning.
Yes.
Let it be so in the name of Jesus. Let all who believe say amen.
Amen.
And amen.
Years ago, I'm not going to hold you, but give me a second. Years ago, we went to Mammoth Cave. Anybody ever been to Mammoth Cave? And they did their thing, and suddenly they said, now we're fixing to do something that may scare some people. Right? I know what I'm talking about. Said, if you have a little child, you may want to comfort the child. What do they do? Yeah, they turn the lights out. And he was kept talking. He said, now, by the law of Kentucky, we have to carry something in an emergency condition to get us out of here. And suddenly you heard, and it was a lighter. He said, the law of Kentucky makes us carry this lighter because there's enough light from this lighter to evacuate all of us here. And immediately the whole room was lit up from one little light. Jesus said, I am the truth, the way. No man can get to the Father except through him. He is the light. Paul said it so perfectly today. If you don't know Jesus, or if you got out of the light, don't leave here without knowing him. Don't leave here without what? Hitting that switch one more time. May I introduce Jesus in a dismissal prayer? And if it's been a while since you've talked to him, maybe you've never talked to him, just follow me along. Does it get you to heaven? It's the introductory. It's the way you live your life. It's true. Join me by saying, Dear Lord Jesus, on this day, Lord, I bring myself to you. If there be any good, the good, the bad, and the ugly. I ask in the name of Jesus, to forgive me of my sins, my evil ways, my corruptions. And your word says that if I come and ask, you will forgive. I accept Jesus Christ as my Savior, and I'm asking for forgiveness in Jesus' name. Now, the Word of God says that if you believe in your heart and you confess with your mouth, you are. Turn to somebody and say, I'm saved by the blood of Jesus. There you go. Now, that's not your ticket to heaven. Don't be misconstrued. That's the opening of the door. We're going to set two offering plates, one at this side with Brother Kenny and one at that end. Please make sure you know our guest is well taken care of. And as you leave, spend time fellowshipping, hugging. If somebody's got a cold, don't hug them too much. But we're going to put one plate there with Brother Kenny, and then we're going to put one plate over there at the other entrance, okay? If you want to write, you can write your checks out to Paul, or you can write your checks out to the church. We'll make sure every penny goes to his ministry. Shake hands. Oh, I want to thank also those that helped. Marla's mama's here today. Everybody say hello, Mom. Sister Christy did all that work yesterday for our business meeting. God bless Sister Christy. Shake hands and remember, whom the sun sets free, we are
free,
free indeed. God bless you.